Now I would like to welcome Jesper Dankerbauer from Red Hat that will talk about XDP, Express Data Paths in the Linux kernel. Thank you for coming, Jesper, and we are expecting and looking forward to hear about your talk.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
Thank you.
So XDP is for Express Data Path, and you have to get an X in there, which is a little bit funny, but so it's an in-kernel fast path. And I'm going to give a technology overview, and hopefully you'll pick up using this stuff, and it's already been released in a couple of kernel releases. So the presentation is about this thing called XDP. I want to make people aware of this technology, what it's about, and what's the building blocks we can use, and also understand one of the components that I use to program this, which is called eBPF. And understanding the idea behind using this and why this is a technology that actually makes sense and why it's a good combination. So what's actually the problem? So we actually have these, in the recent years, we've seen these kernel bypass solutions coming up. One of them is called GPDK and another one is called NetMap. It's actually part of TPSD. And so people say that the Linux kernel is too slow. And one of the fundamental reasons is that people are using it for something that the Linux kernel was not meant for. So to start with, for like 20 years ago, Linux was built on the assumption that most packets travel into sockets. That's also why we have a metadata structure called the socket buffer. And this is called skbuf, and we talk about it, usually we just call it the SKB. So this has an upfront cost because we assume that these packets are delivered into sockets and into user space applications. But a lot of the bypass solutions, they show they can do faster network forwarding. And of course they can do that faster than the Linux kernel, because the Linux kernel is doing forward, it still takes all the overhead of putting in ready for a socket buffer, and then, oh, I have to forward it. So we can actually skip these layers. So, but the Linux kernel lacks this in fast path. And what GPDK does, it operates sort of on an earlier network layer. And so the kernel basically lacks a layer before allocating the SKB. So this is what we sort of done. But so, why the kernel is fast enough when delivering into user space applications? So why do we actually need this super fast path? And one of the reasons is that today everything relies on networking, basically, like everything. And the kernel provides this as a core foundation for everybody. We provide this core foundation for networking. And what happens with like bypass solutions like GPDK is that things get into be makes network an add-on, you know, sort of install on the side. And I think it should be part of the core that is available to everybody. So, and another thing is that specifically GPDK, it requires that you maintain a full set of drivers in user space, which has a high maintenance cost. And you actually also have to boot the kernel with very special boot parameters to get this to work. And because GPDK, you cannot get the interrupts directly. So the solution is just to have one CPU 100% in a polling loop. And that, if you don't, your useful traffic pattern isn't wire speed, then you'll be wasting CPU cycles just looking if there's a packet, all the time. So that's the basic model, that you install this and you burn n number of cores you want to allocate to this network processing. It's also quite hard to integrate into products and solutions. For example, GPDK and containers, this is very hot. They're not compatible, because you bypass the whole thing that containers depend on. The container depends to bypass the whole kernel, and containers depend on a lot of facilities given from the kernel that does this nice separation that we today call continuous. And when you bypass the whole thing, you also have to implement your own TCP stack. Of course, you might find someone who did it for you, or find some components somewhere on GitHub that maybe someone else wrote, but this fragments the whole network community that today we only have a lot of TCP stacks that have to talk together between the different BSDs and Windows and Linux, and this will just make it explode even more. We've used like the last 20 years to get this kind of stable between the different distributions, and now this is just going to explode, that everybody's going to write their own TCP stack. And we're going to see all the same problems we've seen in the last 20 years.
Yeah.
But that they don't have high resolution timers enough to retransmit. It will probably look nice in the straight case where there's no packet drops and no retransmits. But all the corner cases that we in the last 20 years fixing, they will reappear. So we need an internal fast path solution where people don't want to do forwarding, for example. That is part of the core kernel, and which also works in concert with the existing network stack, where you use the part of the network stack you need, but not too much to slow you down. And this is the solution is what we call XDP. It's actually based on an idea of mine. I call it the packet page idea. We just operate directly on packet pages instead of before allocating the SVD, and it was rebranded by a guy from former Google and Facebook. He actually also just stopped at Facebook, and he called it Express Data Path, which is a much more cool name than the packet page. And the primary focus is performance, and it is as fast as these bypass solutions. So I want to stress that XDP is not a kernel bypass. It is designed to work together with the kernel. I'll give you some example how they actually cooperate with the existing network stack. It is, as I explained, it is sort of just an earlier packet processing stage that we didn't have before. And we are based on the existing NAPI model, where we have adaptive interrupts scaling and go in and out of polling mode when we need it. Don't need it, so we don't have this model of we have to poll this and use the CPU 100% of the time. Completely as it's been known to work well for existing networking. A big change is that XDP is runtime programmable. And this is a very fundamental architectural change. And we are going to do this by allowing user runs something called eBPF, which is a user-defined sandboxed bytecode executed by the kernel. I'll explain a little bit more later about what that is all about. It sounds scary, but it's not as scary as you think. I only have one slide with some performance numbers. These are actually old performance numbers. I didn't have time to update it. We actually improved it since then. But the important thing is this is a single CPU number, so only
single core, right?
A single core, yeah, single core. There's something called DDIO, which I'll have to explain. It's called Direct Data IO. It's a feature in some of the newer Intel CPUs, which delivers the network packet from the netcard. It doesn't copy it into main memory. It copies directly into the CPUs. This use layer 3 cache, and it's a quite. I have two numbers of information with the two different CPUs because it's quite effective to skip the first cache miss on the packet. On a single core, we can filter 20 million packets per second, and we actually read and touch the data. Just to not make it a completely fake test. And if you do forwarding, we're just bouncing out the packets again, I can do 12 million packets per CPU, and I have also some rewriting of the MAC address, you can do 10 million packets per CPU, per call.
And then I have some where I ran some tests on a CPU which doesn't have this smart technology. And I implemented a software trick where I'm prefetching and I could actually reach the same level. So you don't have to buy the more expensive CPU when these patches are accepted, for example. People have been, those patches have not been accepted upstream, and we are discussing a bit how, so also always controversial how you do the prefetch tricks, because it will differ from different CPUs. But at least I can actually get the same by doing this in software, I get the same performance numbers. And here was the same as the TX bouncing, and I can also get the same level. But this is just showing that this is extremely fast. You can look up some of my other talks where I have a lot of more numbers, but I'll try to explain the technology and what this is about, what you can use it for. So it's basically a new building block for networking. It's in kernel 4.9. I would recommend 4.10 kernel because we fixed up a lot of stuff. And the more recent kernels, it's gotten even more easy to use. The 4.12 kernel. Yeah, I'll get into that a little bit later. So this is a core kernel facility. So I'm just writing the kernel side, and then user space and other open source projects will pick this up and use this. I've written some DDoS protection, proof of concept codes for Blacklist, and I even did a talk about it. You can also look up on YouTube. And there's some guys, there's a new project called Cilium, which also uses this BPF facility to steer packets into containers and do policy enforcements in the kernel by these BPF programs. There's also a project called from iOvisor called BCC, where they're trying to create a user space library where they actually allow you to write Python code, which will get translated and inserted into the kernel. And you will interact to these maps I'll talk about later from your Python code. Yeah. And there's companies that's already using this technology. The first one was Facebook, and they've been actually heavily involved in developing this. They're using it for denial of service protection. And they also have a load balancer. And they actually saw, they don't give the exact numbers, but they saw 10 times boost from their existing solutions, which is something called IPDS, which is also actually a kernel module that does load balancing. But that's quite significant. If you are load balancers, that you can boost that by a factor of 10, and when you consider how many servers Facebook has, so that's like a huge win head on. Cloudflare, which is a company that specializes in denial of service protection, they have also looked at this technology and played with it. I talked about the engineers, and that's what started my idea how to do the packet page, what I called it that time, that technology, because how do they were using NetMap, and I thought that we could do something smarter by just inlining that in the kernel. So they will definitely use this technology. And then one.com is also using this for DDoS protection. I have done a bit with that. So this XDP is introducing a packet processing stage. So traditionally in Linux kernel networking, we rely on this struct skbuf. So that's referred as SKB. So we keep state and pointers to the packet data. So we assume that most packets reach deep into the network stack. So we take the allocation costs and the initialization costs upfront for these structures. With XDP, we change this. We create this new layer. And the realization is that some of the early stages and some of the things you want to do, if you want to do forwarding or if you want to do denial of service protection, you don't need the SKB. You can actually take the decision without allocating this block. And what XDP gives us, it gives you raw access to the packet data before allocating this SKB, and we do it as early as possible. So we implement this as a hook directly in the network drivers, and directly after you do the DMA syncing to the CPU, to say now, just after the DMA transfer, it will allow you to run this small user-defined program, and you can choose if you like the packet or not, and modify it. I'll give you some examples of what you can actually do. Because it's programmable, it is in EPS. So we do have some driver dependencies, but it's not like DBDK where you have to re-implement the whole driver. It's actually a very small thing we're doing, that we just need this hook. And more and more drivers are getting support because it's actually not that complicated. It's only a software limit. So more and more existing hardware will get this feature. In kernel 4.12, we realized that it was difficult for people because we had this driver dependencies, that people wanted to try this technology, and they didn't have the right hardware, so they couldn't test it, and you cannot couldn't develop it on your laptop to see what's going on and try to load your program. You had to have a dedicated server with specific kind of hardware. So in 4.12 we introduced something actually called generic XDP, but most of the command line options is called SKB mode, so you can enable it basically on any type of network device in the kernel. You can attach these programs, and the program doesn't know the difference because it does happen after the allocating of the SKB, but the program, we just cheat the program and say, here's the raw data, roll back the pointer to where it is, and we allow the program to run. This makes it very easy to develop and test these programs, and then you can deploy it on the real servers. This obviously is slow, and I put a link here to some measurements I did to how much slower it is. And it's actually quite fast compared to what you would expect. So this is the drivers with the native support. We have the 40 gig and the 100 gigabits network drivers and Mellanox. Metronome, they're actually trying to hard upload some of it. Virt.io, which is a virtual driver to KVM, it's actually also support. It's quite hard to configure actually, because there's some features you have to disable which are default on. So people had some issues configuring that. That's one of the reasons we made the generic SKB, because it was not the generic XDP, which was after the SKB is allocated, made it much easier for people to work, because people on the main is still trying to get this configured, and they spend too much time getting this working and disabling some of the default options. KVM QLogic, there's sort of I think QLogic got bought by KVM. I don't know if it's how the internal driver developers and different, but they sort of did it out of sync with each other. This one, KVM, is actually for this stuff called Thunder. As far as I understand, it's for ARM CPUs. Broadcom also just came on board, and Intel also came on board with implementing this in their drivers, which is really great. This, the IXDB, that's the most common net card in servers today, I think. Very successful with that. What's it called? 10 gigabit net card from Intel. So I mentioned this eBPF a lot of times, extended Berkeley packet filters. So what is this about? Well, originally it was a filter programming language for TCP. So if you ever used the TCP dump, you've actually used the BPF, but you didn't realize it. So many, many years ago, Matt Jacobson and Stephen McCain figured out on this really long time before really Linux was around on the Unix machines, they needed to do packet filtering, but it was too expensive to copy all the packets to user space and do the filtering. So there was actually a competing solution, as far as I remember, paper that had a filter solution where you loaded it into the kernel, and you load your filter into the kernel, and then you do the filtering in the kernel before sending, and you only send the packets you need for the HTTP now, so you just basically don't copy the whole thing. So they developed a filter language to that. And in kernel 3.18, by default, generalized and extended the instructions set quite a lot. We call it the older one classic DPF, and today what happens is it gets translated into the newer versions. You can still put in the classic version of the bytecode and it gets translated into the extended instruction set. It's quite a different instruction set, and it's modulated or put closer to something that's easier to translate into machine code of the existing architectures today. A very important thing, he also introduced something called maps, which is a generic key value store, and it's even shareable between these small program snippets you can load, which is a very interesting feature to get into. So as I mentioned before, it's a user-defined sandbox bytecode that is executed by the kernel. So it's not something we invented to do FTP, it's actually something that is used in the kernel for a long time, since 3.18 at least. Most of the activities exist within the tracing part of the kernel, where you can load these small snippets instead of when you want to trace what's happening in the kernel. Usually you have a ring buffer, you put this into and everything gets copied into user space, and then you look at it. Again, a problem of getting too much data across the kernel and user space boundary. So they want to do the same thing of filtering and only activating the tracing based on the need. Today there's also something called SIGCOM, PPF, which is you know, small PPF programs, there's filters, has a very specific use case where you filter the allowed, the syscalls a processor is allowed to run. So today if you use Docker or you use OpenSSH, you have already used the PPF, just in the way. So because what happens is that they load small programs, for example SSH, they will load a small program to limit the amount that the syscalls you'll be allowed to do in the SSH, and that helps secure the session. And BBF is also used in networks in many areas before actually this TCP stuff. Obviously TCP dump has been the first user. But you can actually combine TCP dump with CPU steering. So you allow a small program to analyze the program inside the kernel and then choose what CPU this will land on, which will allow you to in user space to have allocated separate CPUs running TCP dump and do complete separation. For example, you can do flow filtering or flow hashing, make sure that it's the same connection will always hit the same CPU, which will make it easier to scale in user space. So when you do that, you can actually get quite good performance out of TCP dump. Usually people just load TCP dump and say, why is it so slow? And if you look at the performance, what's going on in the kernel, you can see all those are locked, everything has to go through this lock, everything. It's simply because you don't use the features of CPU steering to avoid this, and you can actually get very, very good scaling. You have to use some fairly advanced features to get the scaling going. There's a good example how to do the CPU steering, which is what Google is actually doing, and there's a Google engineer who wrote that sample code. There's also for socket filtering, you can load this on a socket. You can have IP tables, match modules, which will load, do matching based on loading a PPF filter. It's also used in the traffic control filtering, both for filtering and actions. With actions, you can redirect the packet already. It's been actually been in the kernel for many years. So you can do redirecting after the SKB is allocated, but you can actually control redirecting the traffic quite a lot. That's actually used by this project called Cilium, to speed up and secure container networking. First, they speed it up by skipping some layers and do more direct delivery, and then allow you to secure the container by implementing a policy check if this is allowed or not. So this is quite cool. With XDP and EPPF, what we actually get is user programmable networking. It's a really good combination, I think, from an architectural point of view. But it also introduces sort of a new era that we will hand over the responsibility, not the responsibility, we'll still try to secure it, but we'll hand over to user space to say, okay, now we can actually go berserk about it. We give you these limits, we give you this sandbox, and now you go and invent something you didn't anticipate. So the kernel side is just responsibility for moving these packets really fast. And by loading this EPPF, we get the maximum flexibility and opt-in from users who want to use this or don't want to use it. It's up to you. So you can basically do programmable protocols and policies that you can put this into the kernel, a handler protocol that the kernel doesn't support and you didn't know about when you release the kernel, because it will give you more access to the packet and you can just modify it. So that gives user space, something that you can quickly implement something. And the really nice thing from a kernel maintainer point of view is that we keep these policy implementations outside the kernel and we don't have to maintain this forever. Because normally what happens, people ask for some specific, they want to do policy enforcement on some bit in the packet, and then we have to implement this feature in the kernel and give user space either a top file or a sushi tail or something that you can turn on and off this feature. And then we get this in and then people find out, well, we are not using this, we didn't want to use this feature anyway, but we have to maintain the code for this small bit to be checked or not. And we have to maintain that forever in the kernel. With this, we get the flexibility and we allow users to do the policy enforcement. If you don't like this packet with this bit, that's fine. You could code it up yourself and find match this bit and drop the packet if you don't like it. I just don't have to maintain this code forever. And you sort of also, you only have to run the program code that you need as a user, not all the other guys who have the other strange idea of matching different fields in the kernel. You don't do this accumulative feature build and you have huge list of features that you get. And it's also something that makes it faster because, well, you only need what for your specific use case you load the program you need to build other programs. That's about giving adaptability. So we can quickly adapt, and it's also, at least for me, easier to maintain. So at least Red Hat customers, they want a long time stable kernel, but they want the new features today. I think that's a general problem, not only with the customer I have, but other people, customers. And this EPPF gives that you can do programming policies, and as we talked about, you know, create a kernel API for every specific policy. And you can, even better, you can adapt to new protocols or a specific policy you need without upgrading the kernel, because we have this flexibility of a programming language you can put in here. As part of the future, instead add room for adapting. So if you want to take this to the most extreme point, you could claim that this is basically microkernel, right? It's a sort of microkernel component. Maybe it's taking it a little bit too far, but so the architectural concept behind EPF is that each EPF, you shouldn't see them as real programs. It's not like you write a huge program and load this into the kernel. It's actually, you have hook points all over the kernel, as I explained before, and they can actually cooperate. So you only load program snippets into the kernel for user space, and your user space is the orchestration part that controls the kernel and loads these small programs. And you implement the specific need you have, and then you glue them together by using something called maps, I'll talk about. And you basically create something which is very modern called microservices. Everybody loves microservices today. Yeah. And if it's inside the kernel, which is for like kernel components, right? So you can sort of back to the video days where micro kernels, that's the thing. You'll allow user space to load these snippets. So it's very, if you look at it this way, it's very, from an architectural point of view, a very different kind of concept. A lot of people don't get it and think they have to write a huge repair program, but you shouldn't. So this is the stolen slide from the Selenium, so you can see what they're doing. They have something called the Selenium there, there's a kernel, and you have some policy. You can load and you have a CLI, and you also have some events going out to monitoring, which comes from the GPL program himself. What you can see here is that we have the byte, what we call the byte encryption. So, what will happen here is that you can see the first program we load here, very close to the makeup. This could be an XDP program, which does some initial filtering or just some modification of the packet. These other GPL programs, they will be after the SKP is allocated. Where you have some more information and do some checking before delivering into the container, and it, as he's trying to show here, he'll do a connection tracking. He can actually check the connection tracking and do some other policy enforcement too. So it's really multiple programs your orchestration engine will inject to control what you want the kernel to do for you. So the programming model is sort of different. So we allow you to run this code in the kernel, but we really want to make sure this is a safe environment. That puts some restrictions on how expressiveness we can allow this program to be. And sometimes people fight a little bit after when they have to write this problem, they fight a little bit with this to get it working, because we have to when it gets into the kernel, we have to make sure we have to put more restrictions on this to make sure that it is safe to execute. We have to make sure this executed in a finite amount of time. So what happens is we don't allow back branches, so we don't allow to do loops. So you have to force the compiler to do loop unloading for you. And sometimes you have to think a little bit different that you can actually use these maps to avoid a lot of these needs for too many jumps and branches. You also do strict memory access and do validation of what the program is validating. What memory the program is accessing. And sometimes if you write your program and you forget to do some of your boundary checks, the compiler, sure, it can compile it, and when you load it into the kernel, you'll get slapped and say, sorry, this I'm not going to load this for you because you forgot to do your boundary checks that you can run outside and access memory beyond this. So you have to do all your, in the past packet, do your links checking, and the validator will then figure out that you did your link checking correctly and cannot go beyond the data that the packet contains, the maximum length of the packet. So these things, so you should see the prepared bytecode as the assembly language, and you basically you don't want to write by an assembler. So there exists compilers from C, and actually also other languages. I've only played with the one from C. And the main compiler is LLVM, and there's some really interesting work going on there. I put up a lot of examples on my GitHub repository, there's also examples in the kernel source, where it looks like a complete normal C program, but it's actually sort of restricted C. You have to adhere to some limits and use some of the defines that are available to you. But it looks like C and you compile and everybody's happy. So these BBF maps quite important. And so you have to adjust your programming or your mindset a bit. As I mentioned before, it's a generic key value store. And prepared programs themselves are stateless, but you can keep state across implications by using these maps. And you can basically, you have to adjust your programming mind a little bit, because if you look, if you play with finite state machines, you can basically implement anything that you want to do with finite state machines. It's quite fun. There's a guy who puts up an example where he implements a token garbage filter, which is quite cool, and explains a lot about how this works and what these state machines are about. And the other thing is that basically sometimes you just create a map, a single entry, where you just control if the program is active or not, or you basically use it from user space and you just flip this bit when you want to control the program to do a specific thing. Which is just a switch you get from user space. You can also do more advanced and say that this is a blacklist. The program has to do a lookup in this list, and if you're in the list, you'll drop the packet. But the basic concept is these maps are controlled from user space. They can also be updated from the program themselves, and the program can share these maps, which is even more interesting. And if you want to, one thing I have an example with is that you want, when you load the program, you get a file handle to this map. That's nice, but you can also export this file handle as a to the file system, and we created a simple new type of file system where you mount this, and you can mount these maps as files, and another program can access them. What that means is that we're back to the good old Unix principles of this is a file. So you just set to the previous iteration, you set the user permissions and who owns the file, and then you have the privilege separation. You can allow an unprivileged program to use space to control the switch you're allowed to via the map. So that's quite simple. That means you don't have to run as root to control, but you do have to run as root to load these programs, because it's quite. You can do a lot of things if you allow people to load these programs. You can redirect all the traffic and stuff like that. So that still requires you new permissions, but for controlling the program's behavior afterwards, you don't need to run as root. So I've talked about this BPF bytecode. How can this be fast bytecode? It's actually not. It's not that slow, but it's really not fast. So what the kernel has is called a just-in-time compiling stage. When you load the program, you can say you want this translated into native assembly instructions, and you kind of get faster than that. So you get translated into this, your bytecode ends compiled into the machine code instructions from the architecture you're running on. And just recently, we completed this for all the 64-bit architectures. Of actually basically done, so they will have good support for loading these programs. There's even smart NICs that are looking into hardware uploading these BPF programs. And there's a company called Metronome that actually does implement this. So this is also going to happen, even though it is so fast that I cannot see why they need to hardware upload. So, what are the core building blocks? What can you actually do with this, with the XDP part of it? So, XDP, so what you are now allowed to read and modify the packet content. And it's quite strong, you can also modify the packet content. What we can also do is push and pull headers from the top of the packet. It's also, I'll get into that. And you can trigger actions from the BPF program where it returns, it has some return codes, and these are hopefully the 5-to-turn code that they're going to have, and I'm not extended anymore to this, but can easily be extended. So HTTP drop is used for the map service. It's very fast to drop in the interfire, but we're just recycling it in the receive buffer. So it is extremely fast. We avoid allocation and we just have the receive queue going in. Only you take a packet out and you have to allocate a new one to refill that place, you don't need to just okay. So you just override it on the next one. So it's extremely fast. HTTP pass, you just pass it to the normal network stack. But it's actually also a very, you can do something interesting. But you actually modify the packet before it enters the network stack. And as you could pop and push headers, what you can actually handle is you can handle protocols encapsulations we didn't know about. That they couldn't implement at this point in time, and there was a new interesting protocol coming up. What you could do is that, okay, the kernel doesn't know this, but I can write a small PDF program which will just can understand this because it's a programming language, I can do whatever I want. And then I could just, for example, translate this new encapsulation into a V, what's it called? A VLAN, an ID, and I could just, inside the kernel, have a VLAN interface for any encapsulation type I wanted to see. I could just pop that in a new writer and then pass it on to the normal network stack. So after that, I can implement whatever encapsulation protocol handling I want to. First, it looks like the HTTP pass just passing on to the normal network stack. It's another niche. You can do something interesting with it, but you can actually do it. HTTP TX is sort of a little bit like redirect, but just transmit packets out of the same interface directly. And by doing that, you can skip some of the checks that you would have to do if you have to redirect to another interface. This is what Facebook is using for load balancing, and one.com is using it for DDoS scrubbing. They put in scrubber parts and redirect the traffic, filter what they want, and then shoot it out again on the same interface. There's also one called HTTP order, it's the same as drop, but it indicates an error condition, and you have a trace point, so you can use trace point infrastructure to get all those packets in the program. You can also return from your program that this is not a board packet, and then you can use it as a debug facility to see what does packets that got aborted and not just blocked. Very, very recently, like last week, we got this week or something. No, it was really, I think it was last week. We got redirects merged and basically likely going for about 14 kernels, which is not least yet. That which allows to transmit out other net cards. And you can steal the packets, and I have plans to do stealing of packets to CPUs and so on. And even stealing them into sockets. So we also try to start a community around this HTTP, so they have a mailing list, people can subscribe to that. And surprisingly, SDF has only been offered 2 months. And we've seen a lot of people interested in this and getting questions about it, and so it seems that people are actually interested in using this. I also put up some ready-to-use HTTP or EPDF code on GitHub, because I found myself, like, it was hard getting started to figure out all these dependencies that I have to do to have to sort of learn this new programming language. You have to exactly learn a new programming language. As I knew C, I could use C and make Pi, but there were some restrictions I need to learn about and the built environment to get this all straightened out. So I created a GitHub repository, which makes it really easy. Go to my GitHub repository, go to the sample that I've done, run Wave. Then I've done some extra effort in detecting that you're missing the compiler. Then once you install the compiler, the make file will figure out, oh, sorry, you had the wrong version of the compiler. And even some of the programs when you load them, it will detect if if you didn't mount the operating file system and you want to export the stuff, and it will give you the mount command. So I'll try to make it like really easy for people to get up. And well, that's also a huge YouTube tutorial that didn't talk about it. I consider giving this talk here, but I think it's better to have an architectural overview first. I've also started documenting the project, and the CEO guys also started documenting some of this. I think it should be integrated into the kernel documentation. And actually, this EPDF stuff has had its own developer community that you don't need to follow if you just want to write the Git or the Edge or the separate community. So future development and the roadmap. So what are the missing features? And what do I plan to do? Just obviously the slide, just merged. So and my previous slide was just that pending action when we just got merged with the redirect. And I'm hoping this can be the last action code because we are introducing some maps together with the redirect, like we can just implement a new map type when we want to do a new type of redirect. So we can allow more of the extreme steering of the packet. The most obvious thing is almost like HTTPTX, where it wants to transmit out on another netcard. And we actually got really good performance out there. As I said, and actually say to get it a good performance by the name take by the way, and we've seen very, very excellent performance. I'm seeing like 14 million packs on 10 gigabits, where the maximum is 14 million packets per second. I'm seeing 13 million packets per second on a single call. And I just, when I add two calls, it's full wire speed and the CPUs are going as vital. That's quite impressive. Jasper version is only available in the 10 gig inter drivers, and more drivers will appear soon, I think. And they see these performance numbers. They also want to support it in their drivers. I've been quite successful of getting the driver developers to do my work. That's actually been quite great. It was hard to start with, and I had to implement some of the first drivers myself, and then I got the driver developers engaged in. Then they're all competing with each other, getting the features in and running. That's good. And as I talked about, so with redirect, I want flexibility by introducing new app types, or you can do new types of redirects. I think I have some slides about that. So my plan is to do redirects to remote CPUs. So what is the problem I'm trying to solve? With XCP, you could handle the large architecture full wire speed on a single CPU core. But if the user stage process is also running on the same CPU, it will take up a large chunk of the CPU cycles I have, and they will actually cause the whole system to be bottlenecked by a user stage process also having to have. Because the packets are filtered, which are the good packets and then the bad packets. I can still get reasonable performance, but I cannot guarantee wire speed. So I want to redirect this to a lot of you. The kernel solutions, the kernel is the receive packet steering. This is what Google does on the servers where they, at least the early servers, where they did receive packet steering. It's a software packet steering where the hardware didn't span this out correctly, where you are receiving a lot of you. And you are ensuring it to remote CPUs. My experience is that the remote CPU still bottlenecks you, and this happens after the XP replication. The other solution, which is what you all see, but you don't maybe you don't realize this, but this is so splitting the workloads out into subcues, and what that means is basically that you have your user space process running on one CPU and you're receiving packets on one CPU. And this basically happens completely transparent to you. You just do nothing. The kernel CPU scheduler will schedule the user fetch process to run on another CPU, then the CPU receiving the package request is now overloaded. So we'll reschedule the CPU there. What happens there is it's actually still a bottleneck because you receive it and it's fairly fast, but now you have to queue it into a socket. This is obviously after allocating the SPV, you must queue it into a socket and you have to do memory counting and you have to do queue management. And this is going to be across two CPUs, and that's expensive to do this. Yeah. We've actually optimized it quite a lot recently in the kernels. But it's still a bottleneck. And what also occurs is that the SPV gets allocated on the C CPU, and when you use user space process on another CPU, the free will happen there. So you have a symmetry going on with the memory allocator behind the scenes. So what I want to do is to allow the XCP packet to be transferred to a remote CPU. And then to do the allocation, the data allocation of the XCP to happen onto the remote CPU where a user space process is running. And hopefully it will likely be the XCP on the same CPU. I cannot assure that because the scheduler is allowed to reschedule the user space process. But most likely it will happen allocation and the free and the same CPU, which is the fast path for the memory allocator. But the other asymmetry creates all kind of funny situations. So to get this working, I have to do C bugging and transfer this as a bug to the remote CPU, else I'll be having the same issue of the socket and memory accounting across two CPUs. I think I found a solution for that. It also implies I have to build the SPV outside the driver. That's actually quite a big change to the drivers I'm enforcing on the driver developers. But they seem to be interested in that because it actually simplifies the drivers quite a lot. Today, what happens is that all the way down to the receive handler and the driver, we allocate this SPV. This is from an architectural point of view, actually wrong. But it's been so built in that everything needs this SKB, and I'm sort of moving away from that concept, trying to push that out of the drivers. It does require having some extra metadata populated that I can use to allocate this SKB on the remote CPU. And that's one of the main problems because every driver will have their own receive descriptor which has this information in different places. So every driver has to implement a little bit translation there. Hopefully, it's not going to be too expensive. Other missing features is a C-patch feature that one will allow XCP to read the hash that's the middle one from the net card, and we also sort of allow to correct it where we could correct, where we allow XCP to correct the C-patch and then use the existing C package theory, as I talked about before, to look at this hash and then re-steer it. Because I've seen issues with like new technologies called VXLAN and even Q&Q, which is VLANs and VLANs, which are not implemented correctly in the NIC hardware, which results in the hashing goes wrong in the NIC, and then they always deliver it to CPU 0. And then you don't have this nice scaling going on. And we could use XCP to either recalculate the hash and do stuff with it, or after you have to redirect, actually do some steering of it directly if you see the hashes just wrong or wrong. There's also the other case if the hash is correct. Like you could do redirect to another CPU, which I just talked about, based on the flow hash. And I don't have to touch the memory at all. The only thing I get is I just get the C patch from the hardware and a pointer to the memory, and I can just from the C patch and say, oh, I actually want you to go to this CPU and want you to go to this CPU. I'll just have a map with the flow hashes and you control that from user space where I want to place these different flows. The great thing is that I don't even have to touch the memory, I just refer to another CPU, and the first touching of the memory happens actually on the remote CPU. It's creating a faster version of the C package theory.
Another feature that we need is something called XTP mark, that we can have a transfer a mark reset by XTP into the XTP mark if you use that. You can use for a lot of things. You can do have IP tables that can match on these marks and you can do all kinds of different stuff. Today there's no communication between XTP and the network stack directly, and you need that. The trick I only explain about this is that you have XTP add a VLAN tag and modify that VLAN tag to do this thing. But it can actually be more convenient in more cases to have a mark if you don't want to modify it. My first practice was rejected because LXD wanted a more generic and slightly larger area. I have to benchmark that a lot, and then the Borgman is actually working on that. And finding a more generic, because the implementation I have is just a 32-bit mark that's the same size as the SKB mark, and that just gets transferred. No fancy stuff going on, but he wanted sort of to redesign this from the start and actually have it carry larger information than is limited to 32-bit.
What about the last address? What about the last address?
I haven't seen his patches yet, and we really have to benchmark this because this is one of the issues of people. You cannot just increase the size, but I think he wants. I only talked to him on the video conference about it, but I haven't seen the patches, but he wants to sort of do dynamically that you can adjust it, and then he will. As he is the guy who wants to verify in the kernel, we will then actually then verify you don't go beyond this limit. To hook it in a smart way, you can dynamically say what the size is going to be. And it's still limited at some size because it would be too expensive to clear that limit. Another feature that I don't have full concept patches for is I want to check some helpers, because what happens now is that when you modify the packet, you have to sort of, there's also some examples you can do that, they have open coded the fix up of the checksum. Because when you modify it, you have to fix up the checksum, and it's embedded in the packet together. Make you pass some extra passing of the packet, and that's how it is, but it'd be nice if we had some more easy available helpers that say, fix up the checksum for me. We already have those kind of helpers from the layers after the SDB is everything.
Could the checksum helper be added to the accept, or you know where you say please put it onto the network stack and that fixes the checksum layer stuff?
Yeah, you can do different kind of ideas. You could do something like that. And say mark something and say I want it.
Yeah.
Fix up the take something. There's also if you want to do this, you also get I also want to export the hardware, we deliver a hardware checksum for you. Which I also want the XTP program to have access to read that. I need that also when I have these helpers, because then I have to modify that checksum and update that. But another use case is just getting the checksum in and then do validation on the hardware is also tell you if this is a bad or good checksum. Today, the dropping of the bad checksum happens much later in the chain of events, and we could actually drop the package earlier, which has bad checksums. I've seen denial service attacks from new data where the attacker wasn't that careful and actually made the checksum wrong, but he was still overload the system because the checksum happened much later in the TCP stack and said, oh, this TCP checksum, the default checksum is wrong, so I'll drop the packet there, but it reached so deeply and then he sent enough packets to overload the system. So it's much faster, and I actually did a hack in the driver and just used that and chose that, exported that bit
I think actually the MySQL module will just match that data and drop it. Still had to go to the MySQL layer, but it was faster than run all the way. Now we can put it all the way out at the edge into Brighton. There's also feature negotiation issues. It's very detailed actually that the paper code assumes that a feature is available, and it's a little bit harder for the drivers to maintain this. The driver might not have implemented a specific feature. And it's mostly challenging if you want to change the structure layout of this. I have patches for that, and I'll fight the mailing lists on that issue. It's too technical. So, what's the challenges when you want to support this for people or customers starting to use this? Like from the system administrator's perspective, customers will report issues and want support, and they might not tell you that they're actually running EPF, and so we need some better tools to see what's going on. That's also happening, that you can sort of dump the programs. It's a little bit early stages. There's different GitHub projects that can do extract in different ways. Hopefully these projects will convey and we'll get a more unified interface how to extract this and do introspection into what's running on the system. That's sort of the scary part, that someone loads these programs all the way in the kernel, and you actually want, when you come and log into the server, you want way to list who's doing what. That is a nice sysdetail where you can make sure to that in syslog you will see the dump, the instructions for every program that gets loaded. I paid with that and I got a little bit surprised, and I wanted to debug my program, I enabled that and I wanted to load my program, then I logged into my machine and then it said a BPF program was loaded. What? I didn't know a BPF program? What's going on? That's when I figured out that SSH is actually using in loading BPF programs to secure what kind of syscalls you can do. There's features and debug, and you can debug features that you can see what's going on. That is basically what I talked about once. Some tools that list these programs that are running. And now you can also get these IDs that get exported, but before it's also a bit confusing when you run the performance tools and you do the performance recording of what the kernel is doing, is you can just see that the BPF program ran. Okay. But now you can see that BPF program underscore and then get an ID. And then you can go back and see, you can dump, save this program ID. And you can, as root, dump and get the BPF bytecode back to see what's actually running. And you also, it's also getting integrated into the normal object dump command, if you know that, where you can disassemble programs. This is sort of also interesting realization that you can also have trace points and BPF, XTP also have names and trace points. But the funny part is you can at every trace point you can also load a BPF program. And that actually means you can on trace on events and trace points are put all over the code. You could also load it on if you compile the kernel with the if trace, you can load it on every kernel function that you want to do. Funny realization is that you can load this program and then you can interact with a map and update a map that is interacting with the HTTP program. So you can actually have these sort of logic going around, and then you can have different kernel functions get activated in a different kind of pattern, you can update a map which actually activates how you control traffic. then all of a sudden, when you realize that, and you can get a sort of, you can share it, but you can also get, I mean, this can actually be quite extremely flexible, and I can control the kernel and make it do exactly as I want it to do. Do more things that the kernel developers ever realized that was possible. A little bit scary, but gave control to users to inject these programs, and we'll see what shows up from the ideas. You also have a trace point for the redirect case where you can monitor forwarding going on, because it's you cannot TCP dump these packets, because it got happened before the HTTP got allocated, and we're just redirecting these packets directly. Extremely fast, but it also means that if you just run TCP dump, you won't actually see these packets like this before that could ever happen. So we had a trace point to make sure that the system administrator can load the trace point program and then detect and see what's going on. Cannot see the packet. Maybe I'll try to extend the trace point so they can actually do some kind of inspection of raw packet data, but right now it's just saying came in on this IF index and it exited on this IF index. At least we can debug what's going on if something funny is happening and someone knows the program we don't know about. So someone's right. So if we have got really needs an internal fast path to battle with these bypass alternatives, because I don't like that networking gets to be an add-on. I think that's bad, because networking needs to be a core service that everybody gets. It's not depending on how you load a specific strange bypass program, and everybody has to implement their own TCP stack, which is just wasting everybody's time and causing issues. So HTTP is the kernel fast path solution, and we designed it to be working. It comes up with the existing network stack, as I just explained, and we'll add more with these maps, and we already do tricks with the VLAN tagging. It'll be lower maintenance cost because it's part of the infrastructure, and it's much smaller change that we actually have to introduce instead of moving the whole drivers to user space. It does introduce a new architecture for user programmable networking, which is very exciting. It does put user space in the driver's seat and put more power to user space by injecting these microkernel components to solve specific needs you have and solve issues I didn't know existed, then I actually didn't anticipate you could do, but there's quite a lot of flexibility you can put in there, and we hope it will all be used for good measures. And yeah, I think that's the end.
Thank you. It seems like you have revolutionized the creation of bootkit.
Hopefully it doesn't get used to evil, at least. If someone loaded a nice rootkit where you redirect those packets that are, actually there's already these capture the flags events. There's already a capture the flag event which had one of the assignments to be XTP, where the system where people tried to TCP on, but they couldn't see the packets because it was XTP had these packets before and they made actions before and executed that so yes, you can actually have a standard way of loading these programs for what you want to do for TCP dump, and you could sort of implement your rootkit that way, because your rootkits hook in before the network stack in different ways. So this is a really nice feature that you could hook into. But the thing is, like I introduced the trace point, so you could actually debug this. You cannot debug the rootkit in a standardized way. And I also introduced that you could pull back the program ID running, so you can introspect to what's actually running on my netcard.
And so you would see the rootkit was activated with something the rootkit developers doesn't know. Even when you do the IP link and you list the settings of the interface, it will say if your interface is running in XCP mode or not, so you can detect that someone loaded the program. It doesn't say, in the newer version, it actually says the ID also there. So you can see the ID that is running and you can say, hey, what's that? And you can try to dump that and get back the code. So in that way, we've standardized it, yes, but we also put in things that the rootkit developers doesn't want, which is you can introspect to what they're doing and see that they're there. Yeah, it's a good question.
If I understand you correct, that there would be a way to do GCP on at a very earlier stage to see anything.
You would have, I'm going to implement a sort of TCP dump like facility, which is the HTTP program you load. It's not going to be super fast because we have to do a copy and we have to do some other things. But it's not part of the normal TCP dump because a lot of people have raised this question. I'm going to do a sample program that shows this. And I'm going to implement something that doesn't do TCP dump of every packet, but just do some statistical sampling and then just label 100% function zero. And so because that's something like you want as a feature also. It's something that's completely implemented as a EPF program. And I'm going to use the existing tracing infrastructure. It has these tracing buffers, link buffers, and export it that way. It's, you can do it today. It's not, I don't have to add a feature to the kernel, which is also another point. It's all available today. I just have to write a sample program so people can see what's going on. Because when you do this, it's really good to use for the live search protection. But you really want a feature where you also sort of get sampling of the packets you dropped to make sure to inspect the packets you dropped to make sure that this is okay. The way you could do it today is just the easiest way is to do the way we did it at one.com is that some of the packets you wanted to drop, we don't drop them with some statistical certainty, or maybe not statistical, but just one every million packets will just don't drop it. Instead, we'll do pass and we'll change the VLAN to go into another VLAN. And we have a TCP dump session running on that VLAN. Mm-hmm. But it's not as efficient as I could actually do it with another program and do the trace program. So you can sort of pick it.
So there would be some way of seeing what's happening in a not in a boot scale, but in a statistical way. Or
Especially
for for production, this is of course important, but for testing that the setup is valid, it's really important to be able to do like a field test.
Yeah.
Even with a little packet feed.
Yeah, to make sure that actually doing this.
But isn't it still more efficient of TCP dump, even if you sample every packet and have to copy it early?
Yeah, I think so. I haven't implemented it for now, I would say.
More questions? Thank you, Lisa.
No problem.